Hey, Rebels. My name is Matthew Barton, and I'm the host of the Rebellion Brewing Podcast. Today's episode is all about 90s tunes. Now, let me start by saying, let's set your expectations very low. I am not a music expert. Quite possibly, I'm going to say something factually inaccurate or historically erroneous because the approach I'm taking in this episode isn't going to be about hard facts. What we're discussing is going to be filtered through the rose-colored lens of our fading memories. I'm coming from a place of scattershot nostalgia. It's not hard science, it's feelings. So, now that the bar is set very low, I want to preface this whole conversation by starting with the idea that there's something interesting and unique to music in the 90s. Something that sets it apart from what came at the end of the decade, namely the rise of the internet and file sharing. But I needed help unpacking the 90s. I've been planning this episode for a while, and the person I think I need to help me tackle this is Nolan Tabashniuk. He was a DJ at Checkers, he was deeply plugged into the 90s music era, going beyond top 30 radio. He has in-depth knowledge. He knows people in the local scene. He was exploring other genres and less known artists. And I really like what he has to say. That's why I'm so excited to bring him back. So let's get into it. Nolan, welcome to the show.
Wow. That was a very exciting opening to this episode. Absolutely awesome. So thanks for having me back. I'm excited now.
Yeah. I've been waiting to do this episode for so long. I'm like, this is going to be a banger.
I can tell. I know you're excited, and thanks for bringing me back again. It was a pleasant surprise to hear from you, so looking forward to having a good discussion today.
How are you doing personally? How's COVID times treating you?
COVID has been good. You know, well, it's been a time of refocus. I think for me, a couple of things happened. You know, we supported our kids, as you're a parent too, so you understand the challenge of that. We're starting to see some return to life as we used to know it with hockey restarting. My youngest son just finished his football season last night, which was abbreviated, but hey, they got to play football, which was great. So the kids, it's great to see some smiles on the kids and the kids getting the chance to enjoy some of their activities with friends. From a lifestyle perspective, I work in Saskatoon, but I've been home since March 8th. So I've been working remotely, and my employer has said, you know, maybe you don't need to go. So that part's been pretty cool. I'm okay with being home pretty much full time. So that part's been great. From a health and wellness perspective, I've had a lot more time just to think about myself. I've had a lot more time to think about, you know, my own mental well-being and my own physical well-being. Like, I took advantage of COVID. I think I've dropped 45 pounds since the last time I sat here across from you.
Damn.
So I've been training. I've been eating right. I'm happy and thankful that I made some of the changes that I did through COVID. But I know that I've been fortunate to keep my work, and our house has been relatively minimally impacted by it all. And I know not everyone's been that lucky. So I guess I should be very, very fortunate to say that that things are going pretty good.
That's awesome. We had to do the swabs last week. It was go in, get your appointment, stay at home until you get your results. You don't know. You're kind of a little bit of tense. The kids had like sore throats and the cough, and it's, you can't send them to school. That it would be irresponsible. So it's a little bit frightening.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
Luckily, knock on wood, we tested all negative and we've been symptom free and everything. But I think about the people who are in that boat who did test positive. And it wasn't just a 3 to 4 day window of waiting and a little bit scared. It's hitting harder.
Yeah. Well, and the common cold is still, it didn't disappear, right? So you get any symptoms, you're terrified. We tested in our household as well. We tested a couple of the boys because we were worried. And just with time with my mother, who's in her 70s and doesn't handle a cough and cold too great these days, we were worried about her. She ended up getting sick, but tested negative too. So yeah, I hear you. It's been it's a real roller coaster of emotions when you suspect that, you know, oh no, well, what if, or what are we going to do? Or we're going to keep the kids home for 2 weeks and, you know, we're going to stop doing what we're doing and have to self quarantine again. Although I guess we'll see how this goes with, the current circumstances and the additional cases and how we decide to deal with that, you know, as a group generally.
what did they say? It was plus 200 cases just this last couple days.
Yeah. Yeah. Seems like there's a lot and you're pinning it on gatherings, but, you know, I think just, you know, look after yourself and be careful and follow the rules, right? And the guidelines and have your mask handy and, you know, do what you need to do.
Wash your hands.
Wash your hands. That's right. Wash your hands.
One of the things that inspired this episode was being stuck at home and having the chance to just kind of go through my old back catalog of music. Because when we're in the office together, there's only one radio and one person picks the playlist and we kind of share it and you go through everybody's tunes. But when I'm by myself, it's kind of my choice. And I started rediscovering music from the 90s that I had never listened to the first time around because I was just a kid. And I was like, there's some really good stuff happening in the 90s. And how did I not know about this the first time?
Well, you didn't miss much because from what I can tell, your dad had pretty amazing taste in music. So you've told me those stories already and I got to hand it to your dad because he definitely does have good taste in music.
I'll let him know you said so. He does have great taste. But then I was kind of like, Mark was playing a track and I'm like, is this Husker Du? Nice. And he looks at me, he's like, you know who Husker Du is? Because he just looks at me like I'm a square and I have no musical taste.
That's impressive to pick out of a crowd, but I guess, you know, Bob Mould's got a pretty distinctive voice. So any of his projects would stand out once you've heard it. But for somebody your age to know Husker Du, that's pretty impressive. That would catch me off guard too.
Well, the other funny thing was I started listening to Husker Du and then I started getting ads and they're like, oh, look, Bob Mould just released a brand new album. That was like a couple months ago, I think. And I'm just like, what the heck's going on? Did they micro-target me because of what I happened to listen to on YouTube? I don't know.
Yep. That's exactly what's happening. That's a classic example of some of the online marketing that's happening today. And that's one of the benefits of now, you know, being a member and subscribing to a service like a Spotify, right? You start playing songs and then it starts recommending maybe you like this or it injects some other ones into your daily playlist that it thinks you may like based on what you're listening to. Like, what a fantastic enhancement to, you know, as a music lover, who's always looking for new bands. Like, I'm still looking for bands to listen to today. Still falling into the genre of music that I've always loved, but I'm pretty closed when it comes to those pieces. But I do appreciate lots of different genres of music. I you know, I listen to some country now, and I would never, in the 90s at the time, you would never catch me listening to country music. But some of it I like now, so I'm open and receptive. But love the suggestions. The marketing things are great.
When I said to you, I want to do a 90s episode on the podcast, I asked you to say, think of 90s song, a song that just screams to you 90s. It evokes that emotion and memory, smell, taste, touch. What was that song for you?
So I have two honorable mentions first, and then I have the song for me, for my experience with where I was at that time. So 1992 was graduation year from high school for me. So there's a lot of emotion around those years because you're finishing, you're transitioning, you're going off to university. And then from there in the 90s, I finished my undergraduate degree and I did a little travel. I went to Europe and I backpacked a bit and hooked up with some friends, met some family and traveled to UK for a few months and drank a lot of beer. So I had two honorable mentions. The first one for me, as far as representing the decade in my mind, the first wasn't actually a song. It was a band. And it was because in 1996, spring of 1996, I was living in England. And I finished my degree and I went and backpacked and we were wandering around trying to figure out what we were going to do. I was applying for jobs and I was hoping to stay. And one night in the first week we were there, we went to a nightclub in Durham in the north, and at 1 o'clock in the morning at last call, when they flipped all the lights on and played the last song, they put on Champagne Supernova. Where were you while we were getting high? I wasn't a huge Oasis fan. We played it. I was already DJing at the bar for a couple of years, and we were playing Oasis regularly at the bar, and it had some fans. But I tell you, there was nothing more incredible for me to witness an entire bar of people stand on every table, on every chair, and scream along to that song like it was their national anthem. It was amazing. And they kept talking about the Beatles. But in the UK at that time, Oasis was larger than life. So when I think of the 90s, I remember that moment thinking, wow, who in Canada, if we were in a nightclub in Canada, which band or which artist at the time would somebody do the equivalent of? And I couldn't think of that. I couldn't just come up with one name of one band. But in the UK, it didn't matter if you were 60 years old or if you were 21 years old in the pub. They were all singing Oasis in unison because they all tied it back to they're the next greatest thing since the Beatles, and they all love the Beatles. It was multi-generational. So that was my first honorable mention. The second one, for me, I would say was A Voice of a Generation happened actually to me. The first time I heard about it really was in 1990. So I was in the 10th grade, and one of my friends from school at the time was big into rap music, and Public Enemy came out with Fear of a Black Planet and Fight the Power. Giving what you're getting, knowing what I'm knowing, while the black band's sweating in the rhythm I'm rolling. Gotta give us what we want, gotta give us what we need. Hey, our freedom of speech is freedom of death. We got to fight the powers that be. Fight the power, fight the power, fight the power. It made it back onto my Spotify gym playlist during COVID, and brings back some good memories of high school for that. But at the time, Public Enemy, it has so much more context today in 2020. Like, now you stop and you listen to what these guys were talking about and what they were trying to convey and how they were feeling at the time. And it makes so much more sense to a white kid who grew up in the suburbs now. Like, I understand why they felt they needed to get the message out. I understand why. And that was the angst and oppression and, you know, like, let our voices be heard, and we need to do something, and we've got to stand up, and all of those voices from their histories with that group, with those guys in that rap group at the time. So that one really stood out for me now in hindsight as being, you know, a really big album and song and sort of perspective on the world that I wasn't growing up in at the time. So it stood out for me. But I would say that the one song in the 90s for me that really epitomized the era was Nirvana's Smells Like Teen Spirit. Why I say that song is because it hit commercial radio with a storm. So it was, my friends and I were already listening to the Seattle grunge bands. We had the Soundgarden albums. before the big ones came out with commercial success. We were listening to some guys liked, I wasn't a big Mudhoney fan, but some of the guys were into the Mudhoney and the Melvins. And that scene was big, but very underground. And when Nirvana launched that album and that song, the music video with the cheerleaders in black and the janitor, you know, violently with them, like everything vividly stands out as something that was the striped shirt sweaters, right? Like you remember every little detail for me. I remember every little detail of that song and the music video and what it meant. It was the first time you saw that really strong crossover. And that otherwise people would not have commercially enjoyed that band or that track unless they liked metal. So if they were into metal and they liked Metallica or anything, they would enjoy that. But that was sort of that move where I felt like that grunge music and that underground kind of, you know, 90s rock stuff really became popular and could appeal to the masses, right? Almost to the same level as Green Day's commercial success with their Dookie album. But I saw this as much bigger. And you could have somebody who, you know, I'll give you one example. I asked my friends this question. What do you remember? Right? We did an informal poll, i.e. my Facebook page, and said, which ones stand out for you as a voice of an era? And one of my friends, God bless you, Copeland, one of my friends said, you got to talk about Hathaway.
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt.
Right? And you got to give Green Day some love. So what were the chances prior to Smells Like Teen Spirit would somebody actually have said those two completely different styles of music, genres, typically a different crowd, like typically different values, typically different social scenes, nightclubs, totally different scenes, would say Hathaway and Green Day in the same phrase. So I kind of pinned it on in my head that it was the commercial success of Nirvana's Nevermind album that I think really was a catalyst for all those other bands that came after that. So then you had, you know, Blind Melon, you had Stone Temple Pilots, you had Soundgarden, you had all those other, you know, all those other bands that caught on from the same area. And people were more open and willing to listen to it.
There's a couple things, you said a lot there, but there's a couple things I wanted to unpack with you. The regionalism of the Seattle scene existed because there was no internet. It was able to develop and grow and nurture its and become its own thing apart from hair metal and punk that had come before, the disco, you look at the, when I define a decade, it doesn't start at 1990 to 2000. When I define a decade, I kind of feel like they bleed into each other. And I feel like 1992, up to 1992 is kind of like a hangover from the 80s. And then you look at, I want to validate what you said about Nirvana. It happens. It felt like it invented a new genre. It came from somewhere. It grew out of something, but it felt like its own thing. At least in my mind, my imagination, when I recall back at the time, it felt all new and old people didn't get it. It felt like Gen X was putting its foot down and saying, this is our thing. This is our new thing. And at the time, I was too young to get it. I didn't understand it. It didn't impact me the way it impacted everybody else. My nose is kind of pressed up against the glass of pop culture. I was like, oh, that's still too big for me as a little kid. I didn't understand Nirvana till years later. Kurt had passed away long before I bought my first Nirvana album. It took me, there was a lag. It took me years to kind of go back and I bought all the albums at once. And I just sat down and then I digested it. And I was like, oh, wow, this is great stuff. But at the time when it was popular, I didn't get it because I was too young.
Well, it seemed like it came on so fast. You know, like when that happened, it just sort of exploded. Okay. And I'm going to reference Alice in Chains. I've always been a big Alice in Chains fan. Alice in Chains was a metal band, right? They got grouped into the same category. they were doing metal. They were a great band, super talented, but they put them in the same category as Soundgarden and Nirvana. And I didn't see a lot of correlation in the music between Alice in Chains and Nirvana. Like, they weren't using piano strings on their, they weren't stringing their guitars with piano strings. You didn't have a guy like Dave Grohl, you know, beating the hell out of his drums every night, because he did. I mean, when he played, like, it was, I mean, I don't know how much gear he'd burn through in a tour, but man, he was something else at the time, right?
I think of that opening riff to the song, that gallop, and it just kicks you into it. You're just like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But the kids will do it now. Like, it happens sometimes where a 13-year-old will put that on in the car driving to his football game to get himself pumped up. Like, he puts on a Nirvana song it's interesting to see that it really was a catalyst. I think it really was something that stands out, that I feel just had such a big impact. And it didn't. I mean, and I spent the next, you know, it was about a year later, I guess, about 93, I started at the bar, and I worked at the bar from 93 to 96 on and off. Like, it was my life for 3 years, and I was surrounded by that music. And then we added in the Canadiana at the time in the 90s, and that was a whole nother great piece that we got to celebrate through that time period.
You said, what band in Canada could get everybody standing on the tables and singing together? If we locked it into the 90s, I would have said, I don't know. If we had said an era or a singular band, I would personally, this is just my bias, give it to Tragically Hip,
mm-hmm.
because I've seen it happen. I've been there when everybody in the bar started singing the hip. Everybody's heads bobbing, but they were before the 90s and they existed after the 90s. They were a bigger piece for me
mm-hmm.
culturally, but that was more Canadian.
Mm-hmm. Well, and people, I mean, you know, like, there was very few people at the time that didn't like the hip. I was a fan. I'd call myself a fan, but I wouldn't have bought their t-shirt. Like, I had their albums. I played it in the bar. The people in the bar loved the hip. As far as who you wanted to go see live in Regina, because we had so many good live bands that would come through, I would actually pin that in the 90s on the Watchmen, because the Watchmen shows in Regina in the 90s were unreal. They were always jam-packed, sold out, super high energy. They'd play for God knows how long for their sets.
Were they plugging in like Oasis with age 60 to age 18?
No.
So it didn't have that kind of cultural
catch? It didn't. And they were from Winnipeg.
Yeah.
So Regina was a logical trip for them to play, right? They could come and play and go home. They didn't have to travel halfway across the country. So here, for me, on the live scene, that was it. But you're right. Like, you wouldn't close a bar down and throw a Watchmen song and see everybody sing. So it wasn't that, you know, cult-like where it was in the UK with Oasis at the time.
When I think back to Oasis, my recollection of it is mostly through the filter of Much Music. It didn't impact me personally the way it impacted the UK. But then when you go back and you listen to those articles and you read what they're saying and how big their egos were, how insanely invested in themselves.
Obtuse. Yeah.
I could not believe. I'm like, who the fuck are you to talk about yourself that way? But I didn't live in the UK. I didn't understand the culture.
Yeah.
But you just kind of shone a light.
Yeah, it was very unique. And you're right. Their personalities, those two brothers, were just larger than life. And they really were. I mean, they were super successful. Everybody loved the band. Everybody loved the music. It did trickle over. So it did, there were fans here. It wasn't near the commercial success as far as album sales and stuff as some of the other bands that came along. I don't even recall, you know, I think they did some shows in like, you know, Toronto and Vancouver, but I don't know that they, you know, it really got into like touring Canada. Somebody out there hopefully will prove me wrong with a comment or something, but I don't recall them ever, you know, touring or traveling like some of the other bands, because there were bands in UK that had commercial success. Therapy is a great example, that had huge commercial success in Europe and did tour and did nightclubs in Canada. So, you know, I remember seeing them and they were just phenomenal live.
I wanted to circle back to something else you had said, and I'm really happy that you mentioned NWA, because I had felt...
I didn't, though.
Sorry.
Public Enemy.
Public Enemy.
Yep.
I don't know why. NWA is in my head because of Public Enemy, but yep. When we're coming back to honorable mentions, something that I rediscovered and went back to was Biggie Smalls. Come on. Sicker than your average, pop a twist cabbage off instinct. Niggas don't think shit, stink pink gators. My Detroit players, Tim's for my hooligans in Brooklyn. Dead right, if the head right, Biggie there, and I. Papa been smooth since days of under rules. Never lose, never choose to. Bruise, cruise, who? Do something to us, talk goes through us. Girls walk to us, wanna do us, screw us, who us? Yeah, Papa and Pump. Close like Starsky and Hutch, stick to clutch. Yeah, I squeeze three at your cherry M3. Bang every MC easily.
Take that.
Easily. Recently, niggas frontin' ain't saying nothing, so I just speak my peace. Keep my peace. Cubans with the Jesus peace. With my peace. Packing, asking who want it. They got it, nigga flaunt it. That Brooklyn bullshit, we on it.
Biggie, 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 can't you see? Sometimes your words just hypnotize me. And I just love your flashy ways. Guess that's why they're broken, you're so mean.
Very influential in the 90s. I feel like, man, you go back and you look at his wordplay and his structures and his rhymes and how eight layers deep into a rap, he's referencing lines one and two and making a punchline. And if you're just bopping your head, it's just a bop. But if you're following the lyrics, you're like, this guy is Shakespeare.
Yeah, that's an interesting phenomenon for him, because I missed him. Like, he just right past me. Didn't even really catch the phenomenon. I liked some urban music. I definitely was into some urban music. I was a bigger Beastie Boys fan than I was for most of the urban U.S. rap groups. But the Biggie Smalls, you know, when you watch the documentaries about his life now in hindsight that have come out recently, and I've watched a couple, I've listened to a couple of interviews with some of the people about his life and some of the challenges and some of the trouble he ran into. And you're right. You know, it was one of those situations where it was, it's not the lamentation of a lost legend. It's the realization that this person had some material talent, right? And too often, you know, how many times in life have we seen that where somebody's gone too early or too young or whatever, and then and had some success. And then you look back in hindsight and look at their career, or look at what they did, or, you know, like, I remember when The Doors came out, you know, the movie, The Doors, Val Kilmer as Jim Morrison, right? And that was in the, I think, late 80s that came out. And it was like a newfound, because I didn't grow up in the 60s, I didn't know anything about The Doors. But then we were like, wow, Jim Morrison, he was a real talent. I mean, he was really out there, but he had a real gift, right? So we see that too often. And it's great that media is giving us the chance to celebrate these people's gifts, no different than Biggie, because I wouldn't have been familiar with his music had I not sat down and watched some of those documentaries. But interesting conversation about, you know, his life and his friends and his social circle and some of the other talent that he was rolling with and female rapper Little Kim, I think, and him were real tight, right? So there's a whole story there about how their lives crossed and paths crossed, and they made some good decisions and they made some not so good decisions. But at the end of the day, his craft was he was brilliant in his craft.
I compare him to Kurt Cobain in that basically Kurt Cobain pulled everyone's pants down and tripped them up and ran way ahead. He redefined his genre and what he was doing. Biggie, I think, did the same for rap. He took it to another level. He, in his genre, in his mode, he redefined and changed it.
Yeah, but Kurt didn't want that. Kurt didn't want to lead anything. He just wanted to make his music and he wanted to go home, right? So much good stock footage of him and the band being guests on shows and being like, I don't want to be here. like, I want nothing to do with this. They had to go on that one show in the UK, and they were supposed to lip sync Smells Like Teen Spirit, right? I mean, that, if you can find that online, it's such a good video to watch. I mean, he just totally destroyed the whole show because he sang it all gothic and they all fake strummed on their instruments and fake beat on the drums. It was a total train wreck. But he didn't care. He just didn't want that. He didn't want the attention.
People liked him more for doing that, for refusing to build up the facade and play along.
Yeah.
He didn't want to be a dancing monkey.
No.
So he's like, I'm blowing this up.
But he was already there. You know, like, he was already put on that pedestal. The record labels had given him those opportunities. They were building agendas for him. They were flying them all over the place for appearances and TV shows and all of these large commercial things that, as a band in Seattle playing in your basement or nightclubs or pool halls, like, that wasn't their scene. They just wanted to make their music, right? And be loud and you know, blow amps and just have fun.
And I told you before we started recording that I had said the 90s song was Till I Hear It From You,
mm-hmm,
by Gin Blossoms.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't ask, you shouldn't have told me. First I'd laugh, but now you're sinking in fast. Whatever lives on me. Well, baby, I don't wanna take advice from fools. I'll just figure everything is cool until I hear it from you. It's hard, the memory's faded. Who gets what they say? It's likely they're just jealous and jaded. Well, maybe I don't wanna take advice from fools. I just think everything is cool until I hear it from
It's like a time capsule. It can't exist before or after. The clothing, the music video, the lighting, everything screams, that's the 90s to me.
Yeah.
Of a genre of, dare I say, white people music.
Okay.
Because I wanted to honor hip hop and a couple of the other pieces, but just culturally,
mm-hmm,
I feel like that's a time capsule of a moment.
It is for, I would agree with you on that for a couple of reasons. A lot of my musician friends who are good guitar players love the Gin Blossoms. They loved the writing, the riffs, the guitar lines in most of those songs. A lot of the mellow ones and the ballads and from, that was Congratulations, I'm Sorry, I think was the album, right? So
that was the one after.
His
name escapes me.
New Miserable Experience was the big album for the Gin Blossoms.
Douglas Hopkins. Former lead guitarist for the rock band.
Oh, yeah, Gin Blossoms, yeah, yeah. Found. Yeah. So,
after Doug Hopkins died,
yes,
they released the album Congratulations, I'm Sorry.
Right.
And my understanding is they released that with that name because they had gotten so big so quickly, but he had passed. So it was like in this middle of this tragic sadness.
Yeah, yeah. So, And they were in the middle of some recognition and success, right? They were doing okay. They were selling some albums. They were certainly wasn't any global massive, you know, fan base, but they certainly were, you know, on the college rock scene, which was big in the U.S. and in Canada. They were big, and they were crossing over into commercial. And then that song really gained some commercial radio popularity, right? It's so many good songs. That New Miserable Experience album, I think I bought that CD actually three times, as I burned it out, like it was destroyed, and I had to go buy it again brand new so I could keep playing it.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, because it just was so used and in my car and played in the bar so much that that was one. I think I still have two copies in my, yeah.
Because the average CD, its lifespan is between 3 to 5 years before it starts getting lossy. And once you get to about 10 years, then you know you've got a compromised physical product because the plastic just degrades.
Right.
Like it's, the data just does not retain itself.
Yeah, unless it's thrown on the back seat of your car while you're driving and then put back in your CD player. Because unfortunately, while I was actively in listening to CDs when I was in university, I was throwing them on my seats and sticking them in my visor, and it didn't matter to me at the time. I just loved the music, and if it skipped, I'd just skip over that part of the song or something until I could go get another copy of the album.
So. I have a disc planer still.
Oh,
where you can actually, you get the spray, you spray the disc,
yeah,
plug it in, and it planes the disc and kind of flattens everything out so you can keep listening. And
wow, look at you.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It was like one of the investments that paid for itself when my kid kicked over my Xbox a couple times. You know, the disc gets that grinding crunch noise.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, crap, I can't play this anymore. And you plane the disc. I've had that thing for like 15 years. It's
interesting.
Still saving
and
money.
It works.
Yeah.
Interesting. I never had one of those. I remember seeing it thinking it was a gimmick, but I never bought one. So
you think it's phony.
Yeah.
But it just worked, and it saved me like $70 twice.
Nice.
Paid for itself.
Nice.
There's one thing that you mentioned that was also crossing my mind. The influence of college rock radio, which I don't know. I don't think it's a thing anymore, is it?
Well, you know, I think education funding has changed, right? I don't know that, you know, we had student-run radio stations. For me, college rock radio was a bit of a generic term that I would use to once I had ready access to the internet, which would have been, about like mid-late 90s, right? One of the things I found was an online tuner where you could listen to radio stations across the world. So I would search for alternative music genre radio stations. And there was one at a college in Huntington, Indiana, I think. And I can't remember the it was like CFOH radio or whatever. And it was so good. I got so many new bands. It was the first place I ever heard Texas Is the Reason, which I'm a huge fan. One of my all-time favorite bands, Revelation Records. And I was introduced to so many bands from that. And they didn't have any hosts. There was really no talking. There was just a bunch of kids that were like, you know, skateboarders that went to school there, and they played the music so that it was in the hallways of the building, but we could get it online. So I'd listen to that sometimes. So that's what college rock radio meant to me, was that one always stood out. We had, CJTR, I think. No, I can't remember the label, but there was a radio station here in Regina.
CJTR still operates.
Yeah. So that's community radio now, right? So I think they were broadcasting, if I'm not mistaken, from the student union building, the old student union building at the U of R at one point. And so you had people in there. They had a music library. They were great. They put on events. They did fundraising events. They booked shows. They sponsored the No Contest, which, oh my goodness, totally forgot about that. They had a music festival with a huge band lineup. They'd have 8-10 bands play over a weekend or whatever. And that was always a big gig for everybody to go. We all went, all ages shows. It was great.
Deadly. I want to get into this beer. I know we've been looking at it, eyeing it up. It's called Solo Crush. What's unique about this beer is every single batch that comes out features a different single hop. I haven't tasted this one yet. This is the Cashmere Hopped Solo Crush.
So wet cashmere, that's what the can says on the bottom?
Yes. I'll explain what that means in a sec.
Yeah.
So this beer is wet hopped. I don't know if you've had a lot of wet hop beers in the past. In the process of producing a beer, you can wet hop it or dry hop it. That means how the hops have been handled before they're put into the kettle or before the beer is exposed to the hops. Wet hops are untreated, unprocessed, picked from the vine, brewed as fast as possible. Dry hops are ones that have been pelletized, compressed, chopped up into little kind of hamster-sized pellets, and then tossed in.
Interesting.
The problem with wet hopping is you have about 24 hours to handle that hop before it gets stank and cheesy and oxidizes. it's a very volatile compound. The thing that you want, that little yellow powder in the hop cone, that's what gives the flavor and the aroma. Soon as you expose it to oxygen and after it's been picked off the vine, it's turning. It's going to die. Like, it is on its deathbed. So you are either racing to dry it out and preserve as much of it you can and get it pelletized or packaged in an anaerobic environment. We want to get away from oxygen, or you throw it into the kettle as fast as you can. We drove out to Shepherd Farms near Moosomin. This is Saskatchewan hop farm. These guys, they have fields of hops, about 10 acres. Mark literally walked into the field with them, picked these hops, helped feed them into the machine. Like Mark Heise, he was grinding the hops in his hands and like smelling them. We rushed all the way back from Moosomin. Zal and Vanessa are ready with the kettle. They have it hot. It's ready to go. They're like, get those hops in there. It is time to brew this. We cannot waste any time, because every second that passes, we lose flavor, we lose aroma. You can only really get true wet hop beers maybe 2 months a year.
Interesting.
Really rare, really special.
Excellent. Cheers.
That's a long story.
It's great.
Cheers. Oh, it smells good. It smells grassy.
It does smell absolutely delicious. It's got a much different start, I think, when you get your first step. It starts different, right?
If you're not used to wet hop, it's going to be a lot more raw.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think I even get a little bit of onion in the flavor. On the back of my mouth, you kind of burp a little bit, and you get that, like, raw, earthy onion kind of character. And that is a potential occurrence when you wet hop a beer.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, it tastes delicious.
Big citrus.
Yeah, big time. I love all of the pails. Love all of them.
Well, this is, I would say, halfway to an IPA, closer to an IPA than a pale ale. Maybe you could argue that it's technically a pale ale.
Right.
I mean, it's not splitting hairs. I'm not the expert to decide whether it's an IPA or a pale ale. I would say it's closer to an IPA, but maybe you could say it's pale ale.
Okay.
That's not a definitive answer.
So if you wet hop a beer with the different types of hops, how different can, because you've got two different ones, right? With the solo, you've got the wet, the JGL. Comet, that's what I was thinking of.
Yeah.
The Comet and this one.
And Cashmere.
And Cashmere. So how different do you expect the flavor profile to be between those two different hop styles?
I had no idea until I just tasted this 5 minutes ago how strikingly in contrast the difference would be. Comet is probably my number one or number two favorite beer this year. Juicy, peachy, stone fruit, bright citrus. Much brighter, much more juicy, much more delicious, I would say, than this one. This is not bad. This is different.
Mm-hmm.
It's like fuzzy peaches candy,
right,
on that finish. And it's just like, oh, I can't wait to have another sip. So good.
Nice.
This, I would say, reminds me more of a West Coast. What do you usually drink?
What do I usually drink? I have been all over the map recently. You know what? I'll have to actually check my Untappd to see, because I've really been sort of touring geography on the beers that I've been drinking lately. I need to go check this out, because
is that a function of getting into craft beer, or is that a function of just who you are?
Well, I would say so. I've always been into craft beer. Yeah. I really have. I always like different beer. You know, I remember as a 19 and 20 year old, it was the Sapporo jugs for me. Like, I didn't, you know, I liked the cool big metal jug, and I liked the taste of the beer. My mom was from England. I liked Guinness. So I would drink Guinness. And then I got introduced to some of the Irishes and the Reds, the Caffreys and, Smithwick's and some of those relatively early when I was in my 20s. So I've always really liked that. And I've always, I like to cook, but I'm not a great cook. I don't study the craft, but I do like to cook and I like to do things different at home sometimes. So I've always appreciated something different in a beer, right? Right now, actually, what I've been drinking the most is the Cat's Got the Cream. That's what I've been drinking a lot of.
What drew you to Cats?
Well, I thought cinnamon and beer. And I was kind of like, okay, I don't know how that's going to go. Because I didn't really make a connection that, like, I've had pumpkin beers before.
Yeah.
But I never really made the connection. When I got out of pumpkin beer, I wasn't thinking about cinnamon. But then, you know, I think you guys had an ad or something, or you just launched a new batch. I think it just became available a couple weeks ago. And so I went and bought, because I hadn't tried it yet. And I really like it. I really like it. It's like an amber on steroids for me. That's how I look at it. It's I love the taste of it. And I always try the different. I like the seasonal ones that come out. I've been drinking the Solo, but it's been the Comet is what I've been drinking.
How was recently. It for you?
What it was you it was great. I loved it. I loved it absolutely. I loved that. The other one, one of my favorite pails of the summer was Multinationals Helen. And oh my goodness, so good, fantastic, super mellow, classic pail, but I don't know, it just tasted so good. I was a big fan of that one. And I'm trying to get into the sours now. So I'm trying all of those just sort of progressively. So I'm looking forward to the blackberry today. So that'll be exciting to try. I haven't tried that one yet.
Super approachable, creamy, well-rounded. It's got that lactose addition, which gives you kind of like a slick, creamy mouthfeel. They're kind of cheating, right? Like it's that lactose kind of gives you that additional little sweet pump.
Okay.
And it rounds out with that light tartness and you get that familiar blackberry, beautiful puree character.
Nice.
Like people are going wild for it.
Well, I saw somebody combining that with the stout.
Yeah, Kevin Brown.
Yeah, so I saw that in one of our Facebook beer groups there, and so I'm gonna check that out. I'll probably do that to try it out on the weekend, I think.
Do you do that quite often?
Or I don't.
You just
I
saw don't. What he did?
No, he just made the comment and said it's a great combination. You should try it. I think. The other one I saw was somebody talking about the cucumber beer. Cucumber jasmine. The cucumber jasmine beer, and then adding a half a shot of gin to that. And I was like, well, that's kind of, I would never sit at home and put some gin in a beer, but it's really good.
It makes perfect sense.
It does. It's really good. So I tried that too, but I haven't made it a habit of opening two beers and combining them. I just tend to enjoy one beer in the evening, and that's kind of my thing when I get a chance to, and I might have two on a weekend, but yeah.
Our old secret menu had stout and cherry mead together. So you would mix 2/3 stout, 1/3 cherry mead, maybe half and half if you're feeling a little more punchy of the mead. And it was a secret menu item. We didn't tell people, but people just came in and they're like, I'm going to have Black Forest cake. And the servers all knew what that meant.
Nice. What percentage was the mead?
Was
it hot? Was it like
16?
Okay.
Maybe 12.
Yeah. So it did have a punch. Yeah.
Oh, it was like a glass of wine. It was wine.
Yeah.
It would get you there.
Yeah. Interesting. Sounds delicious though. Sounds delicious.
Circling back to the 90s, what is one of the bands that maybe you've discovered since or that you felt never got a fair shake and deserves another listen, another chance?
I had so many of my favorite bands. My most favorite bands, most of my friends didn't really get into. Yeah, that was a challenge for me. One of my favorite rock bands, 90 rock bands, and if you put it in the same sort of category as like the Gin Blossoms would be a band called Shades Apart.
I've grown like a nomad since I left, soaking in solitude. I go without water, but not without you. 100, 200, 300 days since I saw you. 100, 200 more, it's up to you.
I was a huge fan of Shades Apart. They put out a bunch of albums in the 90s. I think their first one would have been late 80s. And they were kind of powering through at that time. I don't think they're making any music anymore. But I was a huge fan of theirs. And they wrote a great catchy pop tunes. Yeah, poppy love songs that just had a good bite to it. And they were well written and they were super tight as a band. So I really liked them. I would also put two others in the same category, and that would be the Cruise Record Legends. And I know I will give a shout out to Zen from Mrs. Fenson on this because I know he's one of the hugest fans of all time, but the band All. All has a cult following. Its roots deep in punk rock with, you know, the drummer originally being in Black Flag. Way back in the punk scene, and its roots in other different bands. There's a whole documentary on their whole evolution and existence as a band now, because they had a cult following in California. But All was, four different generations of singers. The Descendants was kind of part of that as well, because a lot of the members overlapped, so they just had a couple of different members in Descendants. Descendants put out, 20 albums or something, a huge amount of albums, but All was, which is a great, again, catchy, poppy with a bit of a, really melodic vocals and put it over some, complex, great bass player, some complex melodies. So
if you had to pick one song of theirs, who should I play?
All, the classic All song of all time is the song called She's My Ex.
Every word she said, when she said, I'll never love again. Be my ex until the end, cause I know I'll never feel this way again. She is my ex. She's my ex. She must follow on the weakest.
She's My Ex is the song of a generation. It was universally relatable to anybody at the time who had ever gone through a breakup. And the lyrics are absolutely fantastic. So that would be the song you'd want to check out. The last band I would put in that category too would be same vein and the same cult group followed them would have been Big Drill Car. Big Drill Car was big again, Cruise Records, big on the skate scene, punk band. They put out a ton of albums too. Great melodic stuff. They did a great cover of Billy Joel's Big Shot. That's worth a listen for sure.
But you're way up in the bunker with your head on fire, and your eyes ready to see you. Born and cry in the coffee, but don't love this in a minute. Because you had to be a big shot, did ya? Had to open up your mouth. Had to be a big shot, did ya? All your friends were so not now. You had to have the last
word. The one that, again, keep in mind, I was a little kid at the time, and I don't know why I found this song. I know it was big at the time, but it didn't exist for me the first go around. It was, The Breeders,
mm-hmm.
Cannonball.
Flash.
felt to me like a very 90s song. Just hits 90s. Mm-hmm. The way the instruments are, the voices, the female led, the video, the culture and aesthetic to me feels very 90s. And correct me if I'm wrong, it was popular, but where are they now? Like I didn't feel like they had a breakout.
Well, they were in evolution because they came from the Pixies.
Right.
So we had the Pixies, which was, they were cult following, right? In that punk scene. And then they spun off and they got back together later on, but then the Deals went and started the Breeders and got that going. You are right. At the time, at Checkers, Dance Floor, Pack, when I wanted to fill the dance floor, I could throw the Breeders on, and it was, everybody knew that. So everybody knew a little bass line, right? Great bit. Yeah. Got everybody going. Everybody knew that. And it was a great, great party song. Everybody loved that one for sure. It was definitely a classic in that scene at the time for sure.
I think it's worthwhile for a kid who missed that scene to go back and I'm like, just check this song out. And then go check out the Pixies. Like it's kind of like a gateway to a whole bunch of other interesting stuff that was going on.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and what I love too, I wasn't a huge Pixies fan. I loved the Breeders. That was great. I think they did a couple albums, two albums, I think, as the Breeders. And then the Pixies reunited and they came out with an album again where they launched a single was Alec Eiffel that I remember the videos for. Again, Much Music Generation, right? Like you tie it visually to the music videos.
Were the Pixies insane? Like I have this fractured recollection and it's not a whole picture.
Well, Frank Black was an interesting character. So he was lead singer. And Frank Black was, he did some solo albums there, I think, when the Deals went off and did the Breeders. I think he was still doing solo albums as Frank Black. I want to say he did one or two. I remember the I Want to Live in Los Angeles song. That was a big single for him. Yeah, when he got back together, I didn't really study their history because I knew their music and friends that were big fans. I wasn't a super big fan. They came actually. They played Regina. They played in Regina, I want to say in the 2000s, like 2007 or something. One of my friends gave me a recording because they sold recordings of the concert that night. When you left the concert, you could buy a copy of the recording that was burned to a CD when you walked out the door, which I thought was super cool. but I'd already moved to the island and one of my friends was there and he brought me a copy of this show from that night. So it was pretty cool to listen to them, like a reunion tour or something too. So
where do we go from here? We thought so much about the 90s.
Yeah.
And I feel like we're far enough away from it that we can look at it nostalgically, but there's still a lot of value left.
We need the kids to start playing rock music again. You know? Like, the kids that are, you know, like I remember sitting in the art room and watching Wade Sekundiak went on to start Fuse, I think they were Bluebeard. The band was called Bluebeard. And he was jamming with his classmates in our art room at high school. And they were playing like punk rock. And it was after school. And the art teacher let them set up their instruments in the art room so that they could practice after school. Like, how awesome is that? You know? It's changed. The music's changed. The message is still the same. It's just a different context now. Maybe it's a little bit more unfiltered today with what the kids want to hear in their music. But, I just wish the kids were playing some rock music again. And at some point they will. You know, I mean, we've seen this happen for decade upon decade. Is there's trends and something new comes out and they go back and then, you know, throw that back. But, I'd love to see the next Tom Morello. You know, some 17-year-old kid with a guitar and a bunch of effects pedals doing some crazy thing, making guitars make stupid sounds that you'd never hear out of a guitar, right? I want to see that happen again. And it will. it will. But I don't know if it's going to happen this year, and I don't know if it's going to happen next year, right? So something to watch and hope for down the road that we continue to see that. It's not like that, you know, Canadian rock music scene is dead. There's still bands playing. They're still trying to make a living, and they're still recording, and they're still doing their things. But it just, I guess, because there was so much emotion attached to what was going on in our lives at that time, that it just meant so much more to me then than it does now. Now it's background noise, right? Now it's background noise for me on a commercial radio station. So I'll pick up the odd band and enjoy that. But when I'm sitting on a elliptical downstairs in my basement trying to get a workout in, for example, I'm listening intensely to some band from the 90s that I didn't know. Menzingers. Check out the Menzingers. Love those guys right now. Love those guys right now. Huge fan.
Nolan, I want to thank you for your time today.
Thank you again very much for having me. The Solo Crush beer is wicked deadly. Thanks for the taste test. As always, appreciated the discussion.
Rebels, thanks for listening today. If you have any questions or comments about this episode, be sure to join us on our brand new Facebook group page, the Rebellion Brewing Podcast. I'm also proud to let you know that we're members of the Saskatchewan Podcast Network, a one-stop shop for locally produced shows right here in our province. You can find them at saskpodcastnetwork.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Untappd so you don't miss out on the latest in Sask craft beer. Thanks again to Nolan. Thank you for joining the Rebellion.